We're going to bring up Pastor Hill, and he's going to take us further. Let's say amen for him.
All right, the children were great. Let's give them another hand. They were really small, seemed like all of them were little toddlers. She brought up all the 5 o'clock prayer almost every time. And so I guess it paid off. I mean, it's paying off. So you just thank God for the power of prayer. Amen. The effectual, fervent prayer. The righteous, you don't have to understand what the prayer is all about. Just be under the anointing. The anointing will break the hills. I remember our kids, you know, we didn't have a whole lot of children. We didn't have children in church when we first started. So they just were in the congregation on the benches and the pews. And they wanted to come to every service. Amen. And so the anointing, it just has a way of saturating and anointing, and it really has an effect. I know they didn't understand everything that was going on, probably very little, but the anointing does. How many can say amen? We just thank God for the spirit of breakthrough. Yesterday we had maybe the smallest response, but we had one of the greatest results. Amen. And just like it was a time that God just refilled and rejuvenated everybody. Yeah. We had some that downright received the Holy Spirit in His fullness and refilling in His fullness. And the tongues and the languages and the manifestations of God were just really unusual. Amen. I don't know how many were down on the floor. I know I was. Amen. I think that revival needs to start with me. Revival needs to start with the leaders. Amen. I think it's time for the ministers to weep before the porch and the altar, crying out for God's people. Spare God's people. Crying out for revival, for renewal, for rejuvenation. How many believe that it ought to start from the head and then permeate on down? Amen. How many would like to see all of your leaders, us as leaders, under the anointing, drunk in the Spirit? Bible said when they received the Holy Ghost, they magnified God. Amen. Hallelujah. They prophesied. Hallelujah. And they just showed forth the glory and the anointing of God. How many want God to do it again and do it in a greater measure?
Yes.
Amen. I'm sister, come in. You say yes, yes. Come in just for a second. We're going to go for it. I mean, yesterday when... okay, our focus, yesterday was just, Lord, it's just a few of us here, but let us just start with us that's here. I think that's good. Lord, let it start with me. Amen. When people can see me under the anointing, under the power, it will inspire them. Amen. It's not too good for me to completely surrender. Amen. This sister here yesterday, amen, she meditated for hours, so she was just reading. She read it, amen, this fine print, I guess, real close. When she got filled to the brink, amen, she let loose of the anointing. I mean, that prayer language just was so magnificent. You want to just tell us a little bit because we got a lot to do. Amen. Just tell us a little bit.
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I'm also so glad because I take my cue from the Holy Spirit. And so when the Holy Spirit is leading me, then that's where I go. Now, it hadn't always been that way. I had to come to Tulsa, Oklahoma, to receive the Holy Spirit and to be able to speak in tongues and not be ashamed or meek in the sense of I'm just gonna just be quiet and just kind of mutter. When I came to Northside Christian Church, I got permission to shabak.
Yes, man.
And I'm all over the place. I'm in the doctor's office. Glory be God. You know, just thank you, Jesus. All in front of people, not in the corner. Just kind of having my little private worship. So I want to tell you that again, I'm so grateful to be here, not only in Tulsa, but at Northside Christian Church, where I'm being fed.
Yes.
Meat. Okay? To the point that when I got home, I was so drunk in the spirit, I left a few minutes early. I had to pull off to the side of the road because I couldn't drive. I couldn't drive. I wanted to call somebody and say, look, come pick me up. But then I had to call on the Holy Spirit to take over the wheel of the car. And when I got home, I put the key in my mailbox and I got a letter from St. Francis Hospital wiping out my $3,000 debt. God, zero. And I know that that was the Holy Spirit. So I want to thank you.
Thank you.
And may you be filled, overflowing in the spirit.
Oh, praise God. This is just the taste of what we are believing God to do. Amen. Through our season of complete surrender. Amen. I just think it's just the time for us to determine that we need a lot more.
Yeah.
And we need to go to the point of totally surrendering. You don't have to worry about the gifts of the Spirit moving when you are full to overflowing.
Yeah.
It will just overflow. Amen. When they initially received the Holy Spirit in Acts 10, and Cornelius and his household, amen, they spake in tongues and they prophesied. Amen. They spake in tongues and they magnified God. That's what the scripture said. They magnified God. In Acts 19, when Paul laid hands, they spake in tongues and they prophesied. Amen. So just get filled to overflow and let your cup run over. Amen. And God will speak through you. Come and believe that. God will manifest himself through you. And it was really amazing. Sister Denise, we just felt that everybody was supposed to receive that refilling just today. How many want to see that in reality, in your life? Amen. We are believing God. We might just focus on that this month, meet them next month. Just focus on everybody being as drunk as Sister Margo. Amen. Have to pull off the highway. Glory. Hallelujah. That ain't happened in a long time for some of us right here. Amen. But these are the days that God is what doing a new thing.
Yes.
So Denise, yesterday, she didn't do much. She just said, I got us a song. She sang a little song. What's the name of that song? She sang that song. Amen. It just melted everybody's heart. I mean, you don't have to do much when you're under the anointing. The Holy Ghost will do whatever needs to be done. Hallelujah. I was just so blessed. We were determined that we were going to get a major breakthrough. Just a few of us that were here, it wasn't hard to pray everybody through that were here. Starting with Sister Winston, everybody just got to, amen. But that ain't all. They're just the beginning. It's a lot more that God wants us to experience. Amen. I had today, and we're going to focus on a, what's the name of this? All right, Fresh Anointing. We're going to have a whole lot of leaders pave the way for the Fresh Anointing to be manifested. So that means that they're going to have to be at the forefront of prayer. Amen. If y'all going to lead the teaching, you'll have to lead the prayer meetings too. Amen. Right here? Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
What good for the goose is good for the gander. That's what they all said. What good for the leaders, what good for the members is what good for. I don't think the members need to what? Show us how, amen, the Holy Ghost should be manifested through. I think the leaders ought to be the forerunners, the first fruit. Amen. So today, the Fresh Anointed. Amen. If you don't have the book, we felt that we would just use this for a little guideline because God was already leading us in that particular area. So we're reading the book. If you don't have it, it's in the back. But today we're going to have some of the leaders to just kind of open up some of the vital information that was shared in that book, and we will give them just a few minutes to kind of get you moving forward, because we want everybody to begin to withdraw from the information and the material and the anointing that is reflected in this book. Amen. A Fresh Anointing. This is by Kenneth Hagin. So Brother Williams volunteered, didn't draft him, he volunteered. Amen. He started last week in prayer. Amen. I mean, in the morning time, he comes on Wednesday, but on morning time, he was here on Tuesday. Amen. Thursday morning, we had a group of people that stayed 2 hours, and everybody that stayed were just drunk in the spirit almost. Amen. They just prayed until God just shook this place. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Now it's time to move forward. We're going to have Dr. Williams. Doctor. Amen. We're going to make it by Doctor and the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Full control. All right. We're going to have all of these. Brother Donaldson is going to, amen, he's going to help us to get all of the deacons and the preachers, everybody, loosen up. Dancing. When y'all like to see us dance?
Yes.
Emotional. Sister Denise even say yes. All right. So we ain't gonna hold back. Let's go. Let's receive. Man of God, by certain ways of
Lord. Let's say that if I stay. Here in the light. Can y'all see me? I'm looking good. Okay, praise the Lord. Good to be here. Praise God. And we thank God for Pastor Hill, Sister Hill, the leadership that they bring to us members. We thank God for the word that they instill in us. Praise God. And I'm just going to share just an overview, pretty much, of this book. If you haven't purchased it yet, Pastor Hill has some copies of it. It's very good. How many have it already? Okay. It's for it was done. One of the things that, and let's pray. Father, we thank you today for your loving kindness. Yeah. We thank you today, Father, that you have anointed our ears and our hearts to receive what your word has to say. Yeah. Hallelujah. We do believe your word. We grow in grace because of your word. Hallelujah. Our faith grows. Knowledge grows. Hallelujah. We give you all the praise and glory as we grow in Christ and be vessels of honor fit for the master's use. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
All right. So as we fellowship around the word in this book, the teaching that Kenneth Hagin has, he's a very, if you doesn't know Kenneth Hagin, I'm sure, pretty sure most of us do, very anointed teacher, used in I don't know what gift he was not used in, if you ever knew his ministry, praise God. But we're going to find out today as we study, as you open your book, if you do have it, you'll find when we first chapter, speaking of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, and a lot of people have to be convinced, or we have to come to the conclusion that the Holy Ghost is for us, it's for everybody. And Jesus wanted us all, New Testament believers, to participate and be used by the Holy Ghost. And once I became familiar with the Holy Spirit and found out that it's really a simple gift. It's with simplicity that you have it and that you do minister and that you are utilized with it. It's nothing really complex about it, but if you do not know that the Holy Spirit is mentioned and taught in the Bible by Jesus, by the apostles, it could be a strange doctrine to you. But the Bible tells us to earnestly, really desire the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, yes, yes.
Really desire the best gifts. And we're going to talk about today, just not so much the fivefold ministry gifts is where I picked the book up in characteristics of a fresh anointing. In other words, like the sister who just got up, and she's so overjoyed, over bubbling that she's got this gift.
Yes,
wow, look how it works. Look how he works with me and does things for me. You'll be amazed. And this is one of the this is the one avenue that Jesus used to draw people to his church, into the gathering, into the fold, if you will, the gift of the Holy Ghost, because it's unseen. Which way, let's say, Jesus described it. What does the wind look like? Which way does it blow? All you know is that it blows that way. Where it went, I don't know, but that was the wind. I could tell that was the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So that's how we're going to, we should realize the Holy Spirit in our life. Now, before you can be filled with the Holy Ghost, you have to be saved and to be carrying that fresh anointing like daily and instantaneously get results or be in the presence of God. I can get a prayer through. I can inspire someone else. Let's say the prerequisite. You're going to find that over there in Colossians 3:16. Let's turn there if we will.
Anybody have it? Can you read it out loud if you have King James?
Let the word dwell in you richly, all good. Teaching and ministering wise and upright.
Amen. Let the word of Christ dwell in you. How? Richly. So we have to, that's our first responsibility, is that we have to be full of the word. In other words, know your Bible, know the New Testament, be full of the word, so that when circumstances, situations, our prayer time, our gathering time, or whatever part of the day that you might find yourself, you are already filled with overflowing word of God. Let the word dwell in you. And it says richly. Rich means I got more than I need.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I can pull from my resource at any time.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. So let the word, so when it comes to maintaining a fresh anointing, I can pull from the word that's in me, in my heart. And my mind knows it. It's in my heart. And I'm living it out. We can have a miracle in an instant.
Yes.
Because the word is spirit. This Bible, this word of God is spirit. The Bible tells us another place, it's life to them that what? Finds it. So don't go through life not knowing your Bible. Don't go through life not being full of the word, because you'll get some circumstances that you can't handle in life. And life is going to do what it does. It's going to bring you good ups, and life can show you some downs. And the Bible does not teach, as Kenneth Hagin pointed out here, that God, just because we're saved, we're not going to face any downs. But if down situations, circumstances do appear in your life, you rise above it by being filled with the word. Now, that's my individual responsibility. Be filled with the word. Be what? Let the word of Christ dwell in me how?
Richly.
Richly. That's my personal responsibility. That's the first deal. Then there's another portion of this where he says over there in Ephesians, let's look at Ephesians 5, if you will. 5:18. Can we get it there? Okay, praise God. And I'm going to jump to 17, if I will, also. Let's go there. Wherefore be ye not unwise, Ephesians 5:17. Be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Verse 18, and be not drunk with what? Everybody say it, somebody else. Be not drunk with what? Worrying is excess, but what? Be filled with the Spirit. So just like Pastor Hill has illustrated to us, you know, a drunkard, he staggers, he's all over the place, he talk, he might say, how many, matter of fact, if you go to Pine and Peoria today, there's one that's always filled with wine, the guy's always, how many of you have seen that guy? Nobody's seen him. He's always, and he's walking down the street talking to himself. Just talking, filled with wine, just talking and babbling and going on. That's the characteristics of a drunk. But here he says, be filled with the what? Be drunk on the Spirit. And she was drunk in her car. She's driving home, too drunk to drive. Filled with the Spirit. What? That's weird. No, it's not. It's as a matter of fact, when the first infilling is illustrated in the Bible, the book of Acts, they thought that all those people that was in that room praying, they're drunk. And then the apostle rose up and says, these are not drunk like you, not like you think. They're not drunk like that, but they're full of the Holy Ghost. And this was prophesied that Christians will be, I think it's Joel, and it could be in Acts 2:20 or somewhere in there, that the prophet said that in the last days, this will be one of the things that you will recognize about Christians, is that they are filled with the Holy Ghost. That's one of the characteristics, is that they walk around happy, cloud nine all the time. Even though a negative circumstance in life come, it doesn't pull them down, pull them under. They're able to deal with it. They're able to. But what I really wanted to get to was be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit, because the next verse tells us why we should be filled with the Holy Ghost. It says what? Speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Did your Bible say that? Speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Hallelujah. Making melody in your heart to the Lord. Hallelujah. So speaking to yourselves is how you minister to yourself and you keep yourself full of the Holy Ghost with a fresh anointing. Now, so how do I do that? First of all, you got to be what? Full of the Word so that you can pull something down when you need it.
Yes.
Out of the Spirit when you need it. Hallelujah. Now, I'm going to say, Donnell, how come you never get sick? You don't know when the last time you had a headache. The flu season come and go, and you always miss it. What else? All this kind of stuff. I'm full of the Word.
Yes, yes. Amen.
Full of the Word. I take my medicine daily. Full of the Word. Praise God. Full of the Word. My grandkids asked me this week. They were sick, some kind of virus going around. I don't know if your kids had experiences. Well, Granddad, how come you never get sick? How come you ain't sick? They couldn't understand. I said, I don't get sick. They said, oh, we know we have. I said, when's the last time you heard you came over here? I was in bed. And I said, no. Full of the Word. I can pull down a word if the devil tries to bring me something. Hallelujah. I'm so far ahead of the game, he can't catch up with me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm so far ahead with word. Hallelujah. What do you mean? Well, if you want me to quote Isaiah 53, how many think I can do that? Some of us say, I feel what? Isaiah 53. Hallelujah. How many can pull down something from Psalms, the 23rd chapter of Psalms?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And say it and mean it. Say, speak to yourselves in what? Psalms.
Yeah.
Hymns.
Yes.
And spiritual songs.
Yes. Yes.
Making melody in your heart to the Lord. Uh-huh. You do that when you're driving your car, when you're in your bathtub, or taking a shower, or wherever you are, you're letting the word just flow right out of you. And that's in with your natural tongue.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I can speak to myself in Psalms 27.
Yes. Yeah.
The Lord is the light. Whom shall I fear? What shall I be afraid of? The Lord is my light, my salvation. When my enemies, and they will come. When my enemies come to eat up my flesh, what are my enemies? The things that are contrary to you, doesn't want any good for you, want the very worst for you. So when the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, when my enemies come upon me to eat up my flesh, they do what? They stumble and fall. Why they stumble and fall? Because I'm saying that all the time. So you got to be full of the Word, and you got to say the Word. This is how you are staying full of the Holy Ghost. This is how you're staying drunk in the Spirit.
Yes, yes.
I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm the head, not the tail. You have to say these things. Sometimes they call them confessions, professions, whatever. But you have to say these things. You have to quote the Word of God, the Bible, a whole lot more than you can quote a secular song. Hallelujah. So there's some songs that come on the radio, hit that beat, bam, first note, you got it. Some of Michael Jackson's stuff, we got it. If I put on Thriller, how many of us are here won't act like they don't know what you're going to do? He's sitting here, he's over there. I'll put on Thriller, everybody. Mm-hmm. Where you going with that? So when I say Psalms 27, you should be able to go right there. Oh, yeah, got it. I know. Psalms 23, yeah. Psalms 91, yeah, you got it. Walk around here full of the Word, full of the Spirit. That's how you say full of the Word. So let me get back on. So what is a psalm? A psalm is nothing more, as Mr. Hagin pointed out here. A psalm is meant to be sung. It's a spiritual poem. It's a poem. And if you're creative enough, you can make your own Holy Ghost poem. According to the way you can get the word and make it rhyme. And it should be easy for us because we are a rap artist. Is that what they call those guys? A rappers. Rapper. But we don't be degrading women and all this kind of stuff and talking about one another. We be talking about the word. Put the word in your heart and make it rhyme. Give it some rhythm. And you say it to yourself, why do I do that? To edify, build your own self up. The Bible says in another place, praying in the Holy Ghost, building yourself up in the what? Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Yeah, build yourself up on your most holy faith, doing what? Praying in the Holy Ghost. So, and the challenge to most Christians is staying high. Most of us don't stay high. Well, circumstance or any type of negativity come, we start, you know, before you know it, they say, backslide, back out, gone, lost. Something took them out because they didn't stay high enough, didn't stay high in the spirit. Hallelujah. So when my enemies come upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumble and they fall. So the enemy will come.
Yes.
You know, he came at Jesus. In the test in the garden, and Jesus put the word on him, and the devil left him. Hallelujah. Same thing with you and I. He'll come to us, but we will full of the word, and as Jesus says, he couldn't find no place in me. You know, no place to get.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So let's experience the supernatural power of God by being filled. Another place in the Bible, it says that we're to help one another out. I can speak a word to Sister Holman today that can raise her up, keep her up. I heard this morning she had some bad news. Hallelujah. Natural to be a little bit down, to absorb that with a little discomfort. Hallelujah. But I do know that the word of God gives you the power to go through that.
Yeah.
That if you didn't have the word that you could pull up somewhere, next two or three days, there's come some heavy news, some heavy realities. You got to have the word of God in you to sustain you.
Yes.
David said, I lay me down and I slept.
Yes.
I awake, for the Lord did what? Sustain me. Many are they, O Lord, that say of my soul, there's no help for him in God. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me. That's dancing music right there.
Amen.
Glory to God. Thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my lifter in the glory of my head. So when you will make that your reality, anything else going on has no effect upon you. She can minister to, I'm pretty sure she's probably going to have to. Minister, are you going to Massachusetts? You're going to have to minister to somebody up there. They've heard about you. They're going to look at her, what she got to say. Hallelujah. How do I know that? Well, December, I lost a brother and a mother, so I know. Hallelujah. You got to say something. You got to be something. You got to be strong, or you're going to be defeated. And the enemy knows how to defeat you if you don't have the word. Praise God. Hallelujah. So minister to one another in the word, but you got to be filled yourself.
Right.
You can't be empty. Hallelujah. Now let's jump right over to 1 Corinthians 14:31. If we can, I'm going to run real quick because I'm not supposed to have a whole bunch of time up here. 1 Corinthians 14:31. It says, for we may all do what? Prophesy one by one. 1 Corinthians 14:31. For we may all prophesy one by one, all may learn, and all may be what? Comforted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. But let me just stay right here where it says, we may all prophesy. And if you understand the gifts of the Spirit, prophecy is something spoken to edify, to comfort, to encourage. And we are all anointed to prophesy. Hallelujah. Don't get it mixed up with the office of a prophet. But every believer is anointed and equipped to prophesy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Put out a word that is going to encourage and comfort and build somebody else up.
Yes.
Ooh, how you like to run into a Christian? He ain't got nothing.
Well.
Call best buddy friend up and they just empty. Oh, man. First thing, stay away from those kind of people. Because they're so empty, they'll pull you down. Hallelujah. But you want to be around someone that's going to edify, strengthen you, comfort you, give you some encouragement. So everybody, and what are they utilizing to do that? They're using the Word of God. Put the Word in you. And Paul says, everybody prophesy. Somebody turn around and say, everybody prophesy. Everybody prophesy. Be a preacher. Preach to that person. Put the Word on them. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So everyone can prophesy. And we have to come to the conclusion that we are, and like I told you earlier, the word is spirit. It's life to them that find it. How do I maintain my fresh anointing? I'm full of the word, and I am a spirit-filled believer. You gotta learn how to describe yourself, introduce yourself, something. I'm a spirit-filled believer. Hallelujah. I believe and I do know that you can get more accomplished in the spirit with less than you can in the natural with a whole lot.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I don't think I'm all that good in the profession that I'm in, but everybody else in the corporate life thinks so. I told the story Wednesday night. They asked about, I was in a business setting, networking setting. One of the guys, he says, who knows the guy from Scotland? He was the second richest man in America. The guy from Scotland, who knows what I'm talking about? And the Holy Ghost instantly put the answer right in my head. I know who you're talking about, but I had to years back, had read the book. I know who you're talking about. Name's Carnegie, steel guy. He steel in the railroads. Yeah, his name was Andrew Carnegie. Built a whole bunch of libraries and so forth. And so, to me, what's amazing, I was the only black guy in the room. How many ever been the only black person in the room? You know they ain't checking you out. They looking at you. You don't know if you're welcome or not. I gave the answer. He said, oh, yeah, great, amazing. So yeah, you're right. Then he asked another question. Guess who answered it? I did. Then he eventually said, this can't be the smartest guy in the room. What is going on? Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And I'm trying to win them as customers. So the Holy Ghost can put you in a meeting, in a setting, get rid of a bill.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Make you well, tell you where to go, find you a job, do whatever that we can't do in the natural simply because I'm a spirit-filled believer.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When they say walk in the spirit, I'm walking in the word. Pull a word up in an instant, praise God. Pray for someone in an instant, put the word on the situation.
Yes.
That's what he's saying, prophesy one to another. Help one another. I don't want to run into an empty saint. He ain't got nothing. So we are spirit-filled people. What's a psalm? It's a spiritual utterance. It's something in the rhythm. It's something that you say, speak to yourself. And here's another characteristics of the fresh anointing. You speak in tongues.
Amen.
That's something that we got to settle down on. Speaking in tongues. That's a characteristic of you being filled with the Spirit. There's no way in the world you're going to say, I'm Spirit-filled, and you cannot speak in tongues. You can be Spirit-filled and won't speak in tongues in an unknown language, but there's no way you're Spirit-filled and you cannot speak in an unknown tongue. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And I find it, like Paul says, it's better to speak in, I pray in tongues. I wonder if Timothy's open. Glory to God. So that Ephesians 5:18 tells us a whole lot there, that the utterance, the singing, the praising, desiring spiritual gifts by inspiration of the Holy Ghost, because you're inspired by the Holy Ghost to speak to yourself instead of speaking your problem. The Holy Ghost is going to inspire you to say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me.
Yes. Yes.
You find yourself in a situation that looks like you're going to lose. You're losing. The Holy Ghost is saying to you and want you to say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Someone's going to say, boy, that Kim, I wish she wouldn't wear a white sweater in church. I tell you. Get thrown off. They got to do it anyway. That's what the devil will do, get you to lose your focus. Hallelujah. The word is your answer to anything that we face. I even believe that the word of God will tell you how to depart this place. Stop living. I believe the word of God can tell you how to depart.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We don't have to go out of here in some of the ways that people leave out of here. Amen. Hallelujah. I believe the word of God can tell you how to transition on out. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Oh, y'all. If y'all with me, say amen.
Amen.
It's God's will for us to be filled. Now let's go and see how can we maintain the glow. How can we maintain? We get the glow, we got it, we're full of the word, full of faith, full of the word, full of faith, full of the Holy Ghost, prophesying, ministering to somebody, and then life smacks you, bam, right upside the head. I wasn't expecting that. What does Timothy, 2 Timothy 2:3 says? I'm getting out of here.
Thou therefore endure hardly as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that wants to entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier.
Amen. Endure hardness. That's what kind of a soldier?
Good soldier.
Good soldier. Endure the hardness. It's going to come your way. Hard times, difficulties in life, they'll come your way. We're not taught just because we're saved that we're going to be on live life through a bed of roses. That's not scripture. Sometimes some difficult things are going to come up. It says endure the hardness as a soldier. And if you've ever been a soldier, I think there's two or three of us in here who have been soldiers, it's tough. It's tough. The toughest part of being a good soldier is when you first become a soldier. I can remember what they call it, bivouac. Anybody over here in here been in a bivouac? Yeah. Brother McClellan, praise God. That's when they take you out there in the woods, show you how to live, show you how to keep from dying. Hallelujah. We're not all the comfort of the home. I can remember they opened up some live rounds on us, and they only gave us about that much room to crawl under the live gunfire. They simply said, you can raise your head up if you want to. They call it teaching you how to belly crawl. Crawl on your belly with your rifle. They said, you can raise your head up if you want to. Endure hardness as a good soldier. Hallelujah. So through that, I know how to survive out in the woods. And you have to be tough. You got to be willing to absorb the negativity. You know, not accept it, but you got to be able to say, this is bad, but I'm going to deal with it.
Yes.
Yea, and all these things, I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus who what? Love me.
Yes.
So you got the word, you're coming up through it. You're going to get through it. And you're going to, God causes us to do what? Triumph. Causes you to triumph. But if you're empty, you have no word, what are you going to do? Hallelujah. So as I wrap up here, I just wanted to cover some of the highlights, because you will eventually get this book, How Do I Maintain the Glow? Learn How to Swim Upstream. Gonna have to go against some tough times sometimes. Hallelujah. When things are good, no problem. As a soldier, Jesus talked about that. And now here's another reality that you have to have. It says fervent in spirit. Fervent. How do y'all maintain fervency? It says, just like we did from the start, be full of the word. Hallelujah. Now, I've seen people pray hard, loud, long. What about some word? Gotta have the word. Hallelujah. And you don't have to go through maybe that hardness for so long. Hallelujah. I do believe we go through some things that we don't, first of all, we don't have to go through. And then we experience some situations that take us too long to get out of them. How many know someone looking for a job 2-3 years? I've been looking for that kind of job. I've been looking for that job. I've been unemployed. That long? I better sit down because y'all looking at tomatoes and stuff. I mean, you've been sick how long? If I'm not mistaken, I think Jesus might have asked that question to some. How long you been dealing with this? How long since? And if you're full of the Spirit, full of word, it shouldn't take you long to get victory over some things that we are confronted with. That was hard, Sister Kim. You should, little saint, you should be working, but you should have a job. You should be making money by now. We'll be so nice, you won't say that. What we'll say is, come on. Let's pray. I'm going to pray. We're going to touch and agree. We're going to get an answer to this thing.
Yes, yes, yes.
Hallelujah. Yeah, I know it took Daniel 21 days, but we're New Testament believers. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It took Daniel a little while. I don't know if it could take me that long to get my prayer answered. Hallelujah. Full of the Spirit, fragrancy, full of the Word. Put the Word on the situation. Believe God. Take authority.
Hallelujah.
We have to come to the conclusion that we're winners in this life. And the reason why God has the Holy Spirit working with us is for us to come out okay. The reason why Paul says, I pray in the Spirit, my understanding is unfruitful, because I don't have enough. I'm limited. And I'm really limited. You have to say that yourself. I'm limited.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. But in the spirit realm, you can get more accomplished quicker and faster than you can doing anything in the natural. Amen. If you're walking in the spirit, full of the spirit, full of faith, full of power. Well, hallelujah. That's my story. I'm sticking with it.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. God bless you. Amen. So I spoke on fresh anointing and maintaining that anointing. Brother David's going to take us a little bit further. Can we say amen?
Amen.
He gave me 20 minutes. Praise God. I think 20 minutes is good enough. I'm headed juicy. Amen. Praise God. Well, I've got the second characteristic, which is a gift of praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And so it's kind of funny. A pastor just finished talking about the Holy Ghost. If you do have your Bibles, turn with me over to Acts. Praise God. If you can't make it to Bible study, it's necessary that you do on Wednesday. make space for. Amen. And so what we were talking about on Wednesday was actual purpose. That's going to get you into praise. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but ye shall receive what?
Power.
After the Holy Ghost has come upon who?
You.
Or say me. But ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon me, and ye shall be what?
Witnesses.
I want to stop right there. Why do you receive the Holy Ghost? Why do you receive power from on high? It's to be what?
Witnesses.
Sister, you don't never have to be afraid to be a witness.
Amen.
That's why the Holy Ghost come on you, to be a witness. Amen?
Yes.
Huh? That's why the Holy Ghost blesses you, to be a what? To be a witness. Amen? And so you ought to be able to praise God for that.
Amen.
Continually praise shall be in your what? In your mouth. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Turn with me to Psalms 100. We'll read all of 100. It says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. It says, serve the Lord with gladness. Now, we just learned that serving the Lord is being a what?
Witness.
See? When the Holy Spirit is moving in your life, it ought to be real easy to be a witness. Yes. Amen?
Yes.
It says, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with what?
Sing.
Know ye that the Lord is what? He is God. It is he that has made us, and not who? We ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. What I love about that scripture is it takes all the responsibility off of you and accomplishment. See, you do the work, but God what? God puts his anointing on it to manifest that which needs to be done. Amen?
Amen.
Huh?
Yes.
There you go. Yes.
I'm just getting into some foundational things. Why? Because you ought to know that everything that you put your hands to ought to what? Succeed.
Amen.
Why? Because it ain't about you. It's about God working through you. Amen?
Amen.
And so Pastor just got done talking to you about the supernatural. See? I remember Marilyn Hickey used to say it this way, you just do what? The natural thing. Huh? You do the natural thing, and you try to do the natural thing extraordinarily. You do it exceptionally, and God will do his extraordinary. So you put your hands on it, right? You try to do it exceptionally, and God will do the what? Extraordinary. See? So whose responsibility is it? That is accomplished what?
It's God's.
He said he started a good work in you, right? And he's faithful what? To see it through.
Amen.
Amen. So if you're walking around here without a cheerful countenance, you're not believing that report. It says enter into his gates with what?
Thanksgiving.
Well, what are you thanking them for? Huh? You thanking them for the power. What? The power that has come on you from on high. To be a what?
Witness.
To be a witness. See? The end result of everything that we do is that we're what? A witness. See? He don't just give you the big house just for you to have the big house. He give you the big house for it to be a witness.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Stop seeking him for stuff. He give you the stuff. Huh? But your priority ought to be what? Being a what?
Witness.
And thanking him for the power from on high to be that witness. See, I think we got our priorities a little mixed up.
Yes, yes.
It's a simple thing. This ain't easy. It's a simple term. See? It says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving. I'm going to stop right there. Jesus went about preaching this message that said, repent, see, for the kingdom is at hand. Well, what gates is he talking about there? He's talking about the gates to the kingdom.
Amen.
The word repent means to stop going in this direction and go in the opposite direction. So instead of praising your situations and circumstances, praise God.
Yeah.
And this ought to be a way of life for you. Repentance is a way of life. See, you turn from doing things the world's way. See, and the beginning of doing things God's way is what? It's thanksgiving.
Amen.
See, thank him for giving you the power to change.
Amen.
Y'all getting something out of that?
Yes. Yeah.
It says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving. And then he said, go a little further in the kingdom. He said, and then enter his courts with what?
Praise. Praise.
See, the gates, it gets you into the kingdom. The courts is a little farther in, which gets you into his what? His presence. This is where the anointing is. How many of you all know it's the anointing that destroys the yoke of bondage? It's not your work that destroys the yoke. It's not your work that lifts the burden. It's the anointing. That's the power from on high. And then it says, and bless his name. For the Lord God is what? He is good. And his mercy is what?
Everlasting.
So now watch this. If his mercy is everlasting, you ought not be caught up in sin.
Well.
See, if his mercy is everlasting, it ought to be easy for you to repent. So if you in sin, just change. Why? Because his mercy is what?
Everlasting.
And then it says, his truth endureth to all generations.
Amen.
How many of you all know when you repent, you can change generational curses?
Amen.
And how it starts is just thanking God.
Yes, definitely.
Even when you in sin, just thank God. He'll change your situation and circumstance. Matter of fact, I think Romans say he'll write these laws in your hearts. He'll write it in your head. But it first starts with what? Thanking him. How many of you all know thanking him is the beginning of faith?
Yes.
It's a step in the right direction. Hallelujah. Amen. Y'all getting something out? I think some of y'all are waking up.
Yes, yes.
Now let's talk about the anointing. Go over to Isaiah 10. I know y'all hear me say it's the anointing that destroys the yoke. But it's one thing for Brother David to say, it's another thing for you to read it in the Word yourself. Huh? Verse 27. Now remember, we just read over in Acts 2:8. The day will come, the day has come, where the Spirit, where the power is coming down on high for you to be what? Witnesses. Amen. Verse 27, and it shall come to pass that in that day that the burden shall be taken away from off your shoulder, and his yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be what? Because of what? How many of you all know we're living in that day?
Yes.
So if you got a yoke around your neck of bondage, it's because you holding on to it. It's not because God intended for you to have it. It's an easy fix. But the fix is supernatural. Allow God to do a work in your life. It's simple. Let go. Let God. Let go. Let God. So we having these prayer meetings, right? Well, why are we having the prayer meetings? We having these prayer meetings to get yourself filled so that you can be effective what? Witness. I'm saying this because this church needs to be filled. Now, if we go further in Acts, let's go further, a little bit further than Acts real quick. Same chapter. I'm going to show you something. Oh, this is good, good, good. Boy, I love the word. Y'all love the word. Verse 13, it says, these all continue with what? Run accord in prayer and supplication. Now, watch this. What did they know what was going to happen? Or why are they up in the upper room? They're in the upper room because Jesus said to stay there. See? Until you receive power from on high. To be what? Witnesses. Now, they wasn't asking for power or asking to be effective witnesses. What do you think they was in prayer and supplication for? They were in prayer and supplication that God send the people that needed the same power and needed to be witnessed to. What showed up in the courts when the Holy Spirit came? Thousands. See, they didn't necessarily have to pray for power. They prayed in power. And why did they pray in power? Because the promise had already been told to them. How many of y'all getting
someone? Yes,
yes. So when you come to these prayer meetings, you ought to pray in power.
Amen.
You don't have to pray for the power. Because the power's already been what? Given to you. See, yes. Now you got to pray in power.
Yes.
Man, y'all ought to get excited. Y'all ought to be more excited than me. I'm delivering it. Praise God through the Holy Ghost. But man, this ought to bear witness to your spirit. Turn with me to, what is that? John 14, I think. Verse 26. Another word for the Holy Ghost is the Comforter. It says, but when the Comforter has come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceeded from the Father, he shall what? Testify of me. That means it shall bear witness of the word. So we're preaching ought to bear witness to your spirit. Or bear witness to the Holy Spirit. Huh? So I shouldn't be the only one excited about this. Huh? We got to pray in power. Because when you pray in power, you will praise him. Huh? Because you will see the what? Results. You will see the manifestation of his promise.
Amen.
Huh? How do you overcome the enemy? You overcome the enemy by the what? Blood of the Lamb.
Yes.
But then you overcome the enemy by the word of what?
Yes.
Well, how do you get a testimony? Because you're operating with power from on high to be a what? Witness. Yes. So what we're trying to do here today is establish the purpose, and the purpose is to be a witness.
Amen.
See, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So when you're on your job, you have to be successful. Are you following what I'm saying? Huh? When you find yourself in trials and tribulations, you have to what? Conquer.
Yes.
Huh? Not just for you, but that you're a witness of the one who sent you there. Have faith in what? God. I think that's what the scripture said. And right after that, it said you must believe that what? He is. And that he's a what? Rewarder of those who what? Diligently seek him. Well, why is he being a rewarder? It's so that you be a what? Witness. This ain't about you. But it's all about you. That'll cause you to praise him. Huh? That will cause you to praise him. Now faith is. The substance of things, what? Hope for. But it didn't stop there. It says, is what?
Evidence.
Of the things that is what?
Not seen.
How many of you all know evidence shows up to be a what?
Witness.
If y'all don't get nothing that I say today, that the resolve of everything that you do ought to be a what?
Witness.
Change your focus off of you. Change your focus off of money. Change your focus out of your situations and circumstances. Make your focus be being a what?
Witness.
And stuff will what? It is showing up. Ooh. Hey, turn with me, Hebrews 11:3. My time is up. Can I end on this one? Praise God. I wasn't even planning on going here. Ooh. How many of you got your shouting shoes on? Verse 3. It says, through faith we understand that the worlds were what?
Framed
by the word of God. So that the things which are what? seen were not made of the things which what? Do appear. How many of you all know that God would tailor stuff to fit what you want? That the desires of your heart is not your responsibility. It's God's responsibility. And he will give you the desires of your heart in order to be an effective what? Witness. And so if you ain't praying for power on high to be an effective witness, you might see why your prayers have not been answered. Because he ain't into your thing. See, he into his thing. So praise him for that.
Huh?
Because what you'll find is your thing will lead you further into destruction. And some of you ought to praise him that you haven't got those things that you've been believing them for right now. But if you tweak it, that you be an effective what? Witness. Your priorities are in the right place, right? And he can download. Woo! How many of you ready for the download? Hallelujah. Huh? How many of you ready for the download? So that the kingdom of heaven can be increased. And see, now those things that you loose on earth will be what? Loosed in heaven. Woo! Man, I got to go. Pastor said, I got to go. I'm going to turn it back over. Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory. It's going to stop now. It says, come into his courts with thanksgiving. Let's stand up and start thanking God. God, thank you. Raise your hand. Thank you for all that he has done in your life. Thank you for the little things he woke you up this morning. Thank you for all the steps that you have made to get here. Thank you for the car that you drove to get here. Thank you. Raise your voice and thank God right now. We're coming into his gates with thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Then after coming to his courts, into his gates with thanksgiving, then we want to come into the court of his presence, like Dave says. So we want to praise you, God. We want to praise you, God, for being God and God all by yourself. We want to praise you, God, because you are awesome, God. You are God that lifts up everything. You are God that's able to create everything. You are God that has touched me. You are God that can break that anointing, that can break that yoke. Can we get a little, man, why, if I get quiet, y'all should not be quiet. Y'all should be praising the Lord. Oh, I don't hear you. Lift your voice up and praise him. I can't take you there. I can direct you there, point you to the direction, but you got to go there yourself. So come on now, raise your voice. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. Just thanking you, Father God. Just glorifying you. Praising you for being a mighty God. We just praise you, God, because you created all that is and is to come. You created Jesus Christ who came upon this earth and died for me. I just praise you, God. Hey, Mambelo. Hey, Mambelo. Now I understand. We just had two ministers of God tell you about being filled with the Spirit. And the essence of what we're supposed to be doing is speaking in tongues to edify ourselves, that we may become prophets to edify others. But the whole point of the issue mentioned by Dave, and we carry on. There's a lot more to this book. We'll take it up next week. But we ended with being a witness. Being filled with the Spirit to be a witness. Being full of the Word to be a witness. And see, some of us have a problem with being a witness because we're not really full with the Word. As soon as one thing comes around, the Bible tells us to be filled with the Word so we're not offended. Being filled is a constant thing. That's why you're constantly citing the Word. That's why you're constantly keeping your focus on the Holy Spirit. We're supposed to continue in prayer all day. You don't just hit your knees in the morning when you get up, then the world takes over. You hit your knees in the morning to start you off, to carry you through your day. But some of us in here has lost the essence of being filled with the Spirit. In Acts 19:6, Paul said he laid hands on them and they received the Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit, is the anointing can't be transferable. So I want you right now, anybody in here who has succumbed to that burden that the world has laid on them, has lost that essence, that direction, that feeling, that touch, that ability to let go of the world and just focus on the Lord. I want you right now, just to come down here just to get a refilling. Because this feeling is a constant thing. Come on down here now. We're going to lay hands on you so you can receive the Holy Spirit and be filled again. We're going to lay hands on you so we can bind the things of the world that might have been affecting your mind that's hindering you from doing that what God wants you to do. Come on now. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. Come on down. Right up front here so we can lay hands on you. Now I'm going to take my time with this because I know the Holy Spirit has laid in my heart. I know there's someone out here in this audience right now that's very hesitant about this. Do not be hesitant about this. Lord loves you. God loves you. He don't want you to be locked up in the world. He doesn't want you to be concentrating on worldly things. He don't want you to fight the fight. The fight you fight is on your knees and he'll do the rest. This is his battle. All we're supposed to do is just praise him, stay filled with the Spirit, to be led by him, and to be a witness. Don't necessarily go witness to somebody, but the lifestyle you lead, the lifestyle you live, that what people see as a witness unto others. And they will come up to you and say, hey, how do you get to where you are? How did you break that yoke off your back? How did you get out of this neighborhood? How did you get to where you're going? And then you can give them that word. That word. And it's just a word. Because all you need to say is what? Jesus. 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 But there's someone in here who has a hesitant, has a bondage going on that where it's very difficult for them to say that word, Jesus. I'm going to wait on you as the Holy Spirit deals with your heart. We got time because this is very important. you don't feel as though you're filled with the Holy Spirit right now, that you're being a witness, I don't mean you come in here and you speak with tongues for a minute, then you go outside and then somebody cuts you off on the highway, you want to cuss them out. That's the spirit we need to bind, so you can constantly be filled with the Holy Spirit. So we can tear down that barrier so you can go home and study and continue to be filled with the Word. See, we've been kind of deceived in this time and age right now. We got so many distractions, and that main distraction right now is called the TV. And that TV has deceived us to a point that the Bible tells us to run from strife, to keep strife out of our heart. But that TV has got us addicted to drama. You know who you are. You're in here. You come in church. You're so into praying in tongues. But when you go home, what you filled up on, what you desire for is drama. So you click that TV on and you want to watch that show, want to watch. I don't even know what the shows are right now. When I was coming up, it was Days Out of Our Lives and soap operas. But they then took the soap opera and brought it to prime time right now and called it reality TV and all this other stuff. So maybe I want to restate this a little differently. If you're addicted to that drama, you need to come up here right now. If you're addicted to that TV, you need to come up here right now. Well, let me cut it down a little further. It's not just that TV. Because some of us think we're turning on that TV and we say, well, I ain't watching the drama. I ain't addicted to the drama. I want to get a little educated, so I turn on the news. I'm sorry. The news is just another means to feed you your drama. Because they don't give you the facts. They want to dramatize it. They want to elevate it, make it look like it's something more than what it really is. But for what? So they could keep hooked, keep you hooked on that drama and their ratings could go up. And then you wonder why you can't make good decisions, why you can't turn to the Holy Spirit, because you're not following peace, you're following drama.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
So don't be ashamed, we've all been there. We've all been there. So if you want to break that addiction to drama, come up here right now. Because we want to set ourselves up to be filled with the Spirit. We want to set ourselves up to constantly walk in the Spirit. The Bible tells us if we walk in the Spirit and don't give way to the flesh, we're women and men of God. Sons of God. We're not led by our lust. Because we gotta be this witness. Jose Bakiyanoto. He ain't my merolondo te yete arosi ke paku hurite. Tande ro disa ki eme heronde kuero huta. Mayo rusa hukte yoronde ki ete kukuhuta. My people. My people. You're being led by your circumstances. You're being led by the situations that goes on around you, not knowing that I have control of all of this. What you might think looks bad, I could turn around and be good. So don't let that which you see in the media determine how you're going to approach me. Approach those in which I direct you to approach. Because I desire for you to be led by my spirit, not by your circumstances, not by your environment, not by the news. So keep your eyes on me and you will see that it's I that will pull you through all this and even your enemies. Hede amado ndo se quiero luce. I desire for you all to be filled so you all can walk in the Spirit. You all can prophesy when necessary to prophesy. You all can lay hands on the sick and they shall be healed. You all can walk in this not my Spirit, but in my gifts of the Spirit.
Amen.
But if your head is full with the drama that surrounds you like a clogged pipe, I cannot get through. Cry out, cry out to me, my people. And in your cries you shall see that I am the God. I am the God. Sheheri Mambero Longo. There is no other. Pekiaro Shohuta. So turn to me and let me be all that you need. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come to you right now just praying for that individual, those individuals that did not have the courage to come up here to be released, Father God. In the name of Jesus, I decree and declare right now that your spirit overcome them. In the name of Jesus. And when they come before this church next time, Father God, they be a mighty witness, a witness of that which you have done in their life. So we thank you, Father God. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the holiday that's coming up. We know, Father God, that there has been many who have died in battle, not just the battle under the flag of the United States, but died in the battle of segregation, died in the battle of righteousness, died in the battle of Christianity, your martyrs. But we say, Father God, thank you for the one that died that we may come back to you and call you, Father. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for Jesus. And I, Father God, in the name of Jesus, ask you to touch each and every one that's here right now today, that they may have an awesome week and weekend, that they will not walk out of these doors like they came in, Father God, that you have touched each and every one of them with a fresh anointing, with a fresh anointing. And we give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If you haven't gotten that book, Fresh Anointing, we need to get it. And I just thank you. God bless everyone.
Amen.
Thank God for Brother Michael putting the icing on the cake. That was a word from God.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Father, we just thank you, Lord God, for what you already have started within them, Lord. That you're not a God that, hallelujah, forget the work and the labor of love that they do labor and minister unto the saints. But Lord, you are faithful, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. And you see their faithfulness, hallelujah. And Lord, it is your will and your prayer. Lord, they prosper, hallelujah, and be in health. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, even as their soul prosper. Thank you, Father, for moving in our life, O Lord, in a new way, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for refreshing, for restoring in the name of Jesus.
vitality in your spirit in the name of Jesus. And from the spirit to the physical man in the name of Jesus. We decree and declare, hallelujah, that healing is,
hallelujah,
the children bring. And we take and we receive, hallelujah. He that believeth, hallelujah, receive it. Hallelujah, the manifestation of the healing power of God in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. Your ears, oh God, is not heavy that you cannot hear. Nor that your arms are short that you cannot save and deliver. Hallelujah. But Lord, that what you have spoken, oh God, you shall make it and come to pass. In the name of Jesus. Thank you for filling every will, hallelujah, every purpose in their life, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for moving them, oh Lord, into a new dimension, in a new way, Father God, as you see fit, hallelujah. We thank you, Lord God, that we will support them, oh Father God, with our prayers and with our love in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. We thank you, Lord God, for continuing working in their life, Father God. You're going to put your glory and your purpose, oh God. Leading and guiding and direct them, oh Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God. Even in the children, Lord, alive, Lord. Thank you for blessing them, Father God. Thank you for the angel of the Lord, oh God, coming right about them, Lord. Protect them, Lord, from all hurt and harm in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. But Lord, your word, hallelujah, shall prosper in their life, oh Lord. And they shall have good success in the name of Jesus. They shall run this race, hallelujah, and finish their course in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for setting a flame in their hearts, oh Lord. Glory to God, in the name of Jesus. Then nothing should be able to question, hallelujah. Glory to God, let your peace, oh God, rest upon, oh Lord. In the name of Jesus. Your peace, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. We surpass all understanding, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for directing their path. For in their pathway is life, joy, peace, hallelujah, righteousness in the Holy Ghost. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, that your will be done. Hallelujah. Your will be done. In the name of Jesus. And give me the praise and the glory, Father God. Give me glorified in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of Jesus.
I'd like to thank you all for just hanging a little bit so we can do this. This is off the cuff, but this is family. This is family. We got to get off the cuff a little bit for family. And there's no way after hearing that I can let them walk out of here and not have us pray for them as a family. But as individuals, continue to pray for them because we have no idea. We see some of the sacrifices the pastor made. We see a little bit of the sacrifices pastor's wife may make. But we have no idea what the family goes through. We have no idea. So just keep them lifted up in your prayer. Keep pastor and his whole family just lifted up in prayer.
I remember when we was coming up, they always said the worst kid on the block is what? Pastor. That should tell you right there, if you ever heard that, that you have no idea what goes on, the sacrifices a pastor has to make to cause things to happen to their kids. What the kids might go through. So in the name of Jesus, with a compassion, when you get on your knees or you get to your closet, keep your pastor and his family lifted up in prayer. Thank you for your time. Pastor Hill.
All right, thank you, Brother Michael. Thank God for the speakers today. We're going to be hearing from others later. And we're getting ready to go. The books are in the back. We want to encourage you to get the book. You're not going to get everything from hearing the speakers that's in the book. We want to get the book so that you can get all of the fine points and the things that the total picture of the author is just too much information to try to convey. All right. God bless you. Tomorrow night, we will let you relax, enjoy your holiday, and we will be back on Wednesday. God bless you. We will be back Tuesday morning at 5. Thursday morning at 5. That's it. God bless. Thank God. For everybody, let's all stand. Now, may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, this Lord, and evermore. Everybody stand together. Praise the Lord. Amen.